production of the fetal heart begins 21 to 22 days after conception and is present before the conduction system is established. The conduction system of the fetal heart is functionally mature by 15 weeks of gestation. Fetal dysrhythmia can be defined as alteration of fetal heart rate or abnormal rhythm, either fast, slow, or irregular. The normal fetal heart is regular, about 180 beats per minute at 9 weeks in the first trimester. Between 140 plus or minus 20 at 20 weeks gestation. 130 at full term. Some dysrhythmia are benign and of no consequence to the fetal well-being. In a small number of cases, the dysrhythmia may be life-threatening. To diagnose fetal arrhythmia, I have Doppler method and 2D method and M-movement. Doppler by looking for the mitral flow and the aortic flow, and look for the consequence of the atrial contraction, the A wave of mitral flow, and the Doppler of the aortic flow, the ventricular contraction. And another Doppler, new method, by looking for superior vena cava flow and aortic flow. Here, superior vena cava flow, systolic, diastolic, atrial reverse, and that is the aortic flow. We look for this atrial reverse. Every atrial reverse is followed by ventricular, which is aortic flow or not. This means that every B is followed by QRS. That is how to look for the four chamber view and then the three vessel view. One, two, three, which is aorta, SVC, and pulmonary artery. And mode by looking for the aortic contraction and atrial contraction. Every atrial contraction followed by the box or the ventricular contraction of the ventricle. So this means that every atrial contraction followed by ventricular contraction. If this consequence is present and the rate is average, so no rhythm disturbance in the fetal heart. Benign arrhythmia like premature atrial or ventricular, while looking by M-mood, I found one ectopic beat, and this arrhythmia is benign. Good outcome, 0.4 of cases may progress to runs of tachycardia, so it is very few percentage. That could be injured. How to manage benign arrhythmia? 2 week follow-up for tachycardia. If it is, will initiate SVT, shall we look for follow-up one or twice? And avoid caffeine, thymbatomimetics, that is advice for the mother. If it is disappeared or infrequent, I mean one every 10 beats, it is infrequent, normal delivery, and follow-up and reassurance at ECG after birth for detection of any accessory pathway. Fetal tachycardia, here we look for the rate. If it is more than 170 or 180 beats per minute, it is fetal tachyarrhythmia. The most common type is supraventricular tachycardia. To differentiate types of supraventricular tachycardia in the fetus, we should look for superior vena cava and aortic flow, because this is the only tracing that could show us the VA interval and AV interval, and differentiate long AV tachycardia, which is atrial tachycardia, and long VA tachycardia, which is atrial tachycardia or junctional reciprocating tachycardia, and manage accordingly. Supraventricular tachycardia, long VA, that is the example for supraventricular tachycardia, junctional reciprocating tachycardia, and look here for the VA interval and evaluate it, normally 130, 140 millimeters per second. And here another example of long AV tachycardia, here's the measurements, and then evaluate is this in re-entry or not. Following the detection of the rhythm, we should look for the structure of the heart, because in 5% of cases of tachycardia, there is anomalies like Epstein, atrial ventricular septal defect, AV canal, or tumors. And evaluate the hemodynamic effect of the arrhythmia. Look for the CT ratio, cardiothoracic ratio, the AV valve incompetence, and the function, fractional shortening, and look for any signs of failure, which is high drops in utero, preeclampsia, pleural effusion, ascites. This example of a case of supraventricular tachycardia, mitral aortic flow, here the heart rate 220 beats per minute, and this is at 28 weeks gestation. Here's the ones diagnosed, ELICA for gender view, supraventricular tachycardia, non-hydraulic. Here is the rate, 230, by pulse Doppler and by aortic and mitral flow. We get lamoxine at first, and there was no response. After a while, we look for this LV, and we found the contractility a little bit impaired. Here is the LV a little bit dilated, and the contractility is sluggish than before, and the trace of mitral regurgitation and tricuspid regurgitation. We added flecainide to this mother, and after 2 weeks, usually follow up within 2 weeks. Here is, we notice carefully, LV dilatation and RV, both ventricles, not only that is the left ventricle, that is the right ventricle anterior, and we will find trace of incompetence in both mitral and aorta. And we will assess also the function. Here is the jet, the blue one, mitral regurgitation and tricuspid regurgitation. So there is that. And here we look for the MO. The LV is dilated and fractional shortening 21 and ejection fraction 46. After flecainide and lamoxine both together, on follow up, the rate becomes 170 or 80. And here is the SBC flow and the aortic flow. And we measure both intervals as well. And after this, here is the mitral regurgitation and tricuspid regurgitation, stable in the picture. And here is the time of SBC and aortic flow for intervals. And after treatment, the mitral regurgitation disappears and the contractility improves. And the baby after birth is gone away. Here is the measurement of the heart rate, 170. Relative to 220, it is controlled. And after birth, the contractility is good and trace very mild mitral regurgitation. Another example of a case of SVT with high drops, here is ascites. We look for this fluid around the fetal neck, and the function is impaired, and marked increase in CT ratio, impairment of left ventricular function, and here is the ascites around the fetal abdomen. This baby had elective section because he developed high drops. And the gestational age is 37 weeks, and after birth, here this is the arrhythmia. SVT with high drops, and the fetal heart rate. This fetus with high drops, the prognosis was not good, and actually now there is no flecainide. We gave lamoxine, and if there is no improvement, we added cordarone, but the baby died after birth. He was hydropic. The second type of tachyarrhythmia, atrial flutter and fibrillation. This represents from 20 to 50% of fetal tachycardia. By looking, here is the atrial contraction, superior vena cava, and the ventricular contraction from the aorta. We look how many atrial contraction and all the ventricular contraction, and MO. And shall we look for this flip? Very, very rapid heart rate. Look for the motion of foramen ovary. Here is the two atria. The contraction is very, very fast. Here is both ventricles, two atria. And I will assess this. But shall we look for how fast the atrial contraction relative to the ventricular contraction? Here we reassess this fetus. We look for the atrial rate 450, while the ventricular rate 200 20. So 2-to-1 conduction, and here the M mode of the aorta and the M mode of the atrial wall. Every 2 atrial contraction followed by 1 ventricular contraction. And here, this is the motion of ramen ovary, how much it is very fast, 500. While this is the box of the aorta, 260, 2-to-1 conduction. And this baby was hydropic. Here, from the aorta again, and the SBC, we look for the ventricular contraction and the atrial contraction. And here, the motion of the foramen ovary very, very fast, 500 per minute. And this big fetus actually dies second day after birth. Another example of ventricular tachycardia, I have seen just one case in all my work. That's the ventricular rate, and that's the atrial rate. And this fetus, I have seen him in Qasr al-Ayn, fetal medicine unit with Dr. Zainab. And after birth, it proved to be congenital long QT syndrome. Tissue Doppler may help in diagnosis of fetal arrhythmia. It traces the mitral flow, the aortic flow, look for E, A, and S wave. And by drawing it, we look for these premature beats, for example. Premature beat conducted, however, this premature beat with a pulse not conducted. So it may help for atrial flutter. Every 2 atrial contraction is followed by 1 ventricular. And also tissue color and mood in the fetal arrhythmia may add to the diagnosis. Management of fetal tachyarrhythmia. Sustained tachycardia, heart rate more than 200. As we mentioned, look for CT ratio, cardiomegaly, baby hydropic or not, ventricular function, and gestational age, because management depends on this gestational age. Assess risk benefit for fetal therapy. If we are near term, I mean more than 36 weeks gestation, and the lung maturity is about to be normal, elective delivery and neonatal management. However, if the fetus is still premature, there is expected poor lung maturity, so go medical treatment. We will mention the drugs now, digoxin, flecainide, amiodarone, or sotalol, till the age the obstetrician can go for elective section and manage postnatal. What's the drugs used? That is the drugs used for transplacental. I mean, the mother takes the drug, and the drug passes through the placental barrier to the fetus. Digoxin, the first line, and the most important one, and that is first line of management. Digoxin, flecainide. It is very important drug, and now it may be first before digoxin, but sometimes unavailable. Dramamine, I'd like to put it down, although it is written earlier, sotalol, propofenol, and amiodarone. I know that amiodarone causes hypothyroidism, hypersebesis, but in some cases resistant, and the fetus may die inside the uterus, we use it. We add it to naloxone. We will go now for fetal bradyarrhythmia, when the fetal heart rate is less than 100 beats per minute. It accounts for only 5% of all fetal arrhythmia. So most of the arrhythmia is the tachyarrhythmia. Approximately 50%, half of this fetus have associated structural cardiac abnormalities, like left aneurysm, atrioventricular septal defect, and usually you found both together, left aneurysm with the AV canal, and the most common one, corrected TGA, and sometimes cardiac tumors. So we look for the structure of the fetal heart and assess if there is any finding like this. Example, a case of left aneurysm. Here is the spine, that is the adipose, the very small one, and that is the aorta pulsating. So aorta, and in front of it, and behind it is the adipose. And that is the heart rate is very slow, again. How to diagnose aneurysm? Aorta and behind it, the very small vessel, which is the aneurysm. And that's the case of common in the canal, how much bradycardia, both a bit. common bulb, common in the canal, that is the appendage. It is a case of left atrial aneurysm, was common in the canal and with transposition as well. So the left time, that is the heart rate, ventricular rate, atrial rate. The heart rate was around 50 beats per minute. Another example, that's the case also. That is the spine. We look at first for the sides. And both atria here, both atria ear-like, it is aneurysm, both atria left atrial appendage. That is the two atria, the two ventricles. And here also there is the, that is the origin of one of the great vessels. Here both great vessels, aorta, anterior, and pulmonary artery, posterior. That is the pulmonary bifurcated here, I say it is T, aorta. And the terminus across the pulmonary, and the anterior one is the aorta. And the arch was normal. So it is a case of common in the canal, aneurysm, door with pulmonary stenosis, and that is the Doppler. And the heart rate was around 60 beats per minute, with complete heart block. The prognosis in presence of anomaly is bad. Another group, the bradycardia and the structurally normal heart. We should look for the anti-RO antibodies for exclusion of lobe of the mother, especially after 18 weeks gestation. And there is another causes for this bradycardia with a structurally normal heart, like six sinus syndrome, rare forms of long QT, benign forms, like non-conducted premature atria, sometimes slow the rate down, or transient bradycardia due to cord compression or fetal head compression or maternal uterine contraction. This may cause bradycardia during scan. Non-conducted beat, for example, here, and that gives a sense of bradycardia in it. And example of a case of bradycardia or heart block and the structurally normal heart. That is the full chain view, bradycardia. That is the anterior is the right ventricle, the moderator band, and the color across mitral and aorta, and look for the rhythm. And the structure of the heart, that's the apical fire and the origin of the aorta in the center of the heart. And the heart rate was around 54 on normal cardiac structure. And that is an example of a case of second degree heart block in 2-1 in a mother with systemic lobus, 2-1 conduction, and in the presence of anti-RO, anti-LA. And that is the before treatment, and that is after treatment by giving dexamethasone, not prednisone, only dexamethasone, as it is only process the placebo. How to manage the fetal bradycardia? First of all, look for the structure. If it is abnormal structure, high dropping, poor prognosis. If the heart rate is below 55, shall we get something to increase the rate, maternal sympathomimetic and delivery neonatal pacemaker. While if the heart is normal, go for maternal systemic lobus, anti-RA, anti-LA antibodies. If it is positive, I mean the mother has systemic lobus, we get steroids, dexamethasone, not prednisone, because dexa crosses the placenta, and even if there is an after birth, if it is below 55, so management for the neonate, if the heart rate is below 50, go for delivery and ask for neonatal pacing. I'd like to say here, in mothers with the maternal systemic lobus, if the mother with systemic lobus had a baby with complete heart block or second degree heart block, there is 20% liability to have another baby with complete heart block. But if the first baby is normal, there is 3% only to have another baby with heart block. Magnetocardiography. Shall I go in hurry? Alright. It is only for detection of arrhythmia like SVT. Complete heart block in the presence of structure. The prognosis is poor, and the onset of high drops is an ominous sign. Precise assessment of the nature of arrhythmia is essential, so that well indicated appropriate therapy can be instituted. I'll give two slides only on neonatal arrhythmia because of time. Neonatal arrhythmia, common arrhythmia in neonates with a structurally normal heart are premature beats, as we mentioned, atrial flutter, re-entry, permanent junction tachycardia. Neonatal heart block is associated with maternal autoimmune or systemic lobus, as we mentioned. attention before. Or some post-operative arrhythmia, especially the SVT or re-entry tachycardia. I'd like just only for if religion, we can look for the arrhythmia that could be associated. So that is arrhythmia associated with a specific congenital cardiac malformation. VSD liable for, AV canal liable for, TGA, correctly TGA, and so on. And that is only important figure for all of this. If someone wants anything, welcome. And that is, and my partner, and that is the anti-arrhythmic drugs indicated in neonatology. That is very important. The most common, adenosine, amiodarone in accessory pathway, SBT or SBT saturation, digoxin, phenylalanine, procainamide, propranolol, Hawaiian, verapamil is absolutely contraindicated. 10 to 2 years of age, leave, never together, verapamil, to neonate with SBT. That is the message. And that is the other drugs, sotalol,